I want to know what love is. I want you to show me. That's been the message of this series that we've been looking at in 1 Corinthians 13. And maybe this is a good time to think a wee bit more about what that word love means. In English, it's just a four-letter word with a variety of meanings. But we find in the Bible there are three main words that are used to describe love. The first word is eros. We get the word erotic from it. Eros is a sensual love, the desire, that passion within us. Much more wholesome in Scripture than the way we tend to look at it today. And there is much that is good in that physical side of love, in that desire side of love. So I want to know what love is. I want you to show me, as the song says. Mostly the songs are written to say, in this sense, I will show you, in that erotic sense, in that sensual sense. The Bible has another word, philos, which is brotherly love, which is that connection, like David and Jonathan in the Bible, like within families, within friendship groups, where people are really closely bonded together. It's not a physical attraction, but they are bonded at heart level. Maybe in songs, I want to know what love is, I want you to show me, you could think of lyrics like, he ain't heavy, he's my brother. It reaches beyond ourselves to those around us. But then the Bible has a third word, agape, which is a word that the Bible uses to describe God's love. And it's really coming from what's within God. He reaches out to the unlovely. He reaches out to the ones who cannot respond, to the ones who are vulnerable, who cannot give back. And that's the love the Bible speaks of in 1 Corinthians 13. So we have, for instance, if you want to do it again in songs, maybe the children's songs, you remember it, two little boys. When one goes out to his brother wounded and dying there. So it's philos love, but it goes beyond laying down his life for someone who is not willing, not able to save himself. In this case, of course, he survives. And so often that's the love that God asks for us day by day. Not that we sacrifice our whole lives in terms of give up our life, but that we give of our best, we give of our talents to help others sacrificially. And that's really where it's coming from. And this is where we hit a T-junction. With Bible and Western society, not all of the world is like this, but Western society is very much me-centered. So in love by Western societies, I want you to be self-seeking. The Bible is saying, do not be self-seeking. Love is not self-seeking. So it's polar opposites, two different directions to go and live our lives. Today's society says, look after yourself, put yourself first. Don't let anybody walk over you. Make sure you provide for everything that you need and that your friends need. And as long as your little world is okay, then look within as well. If you're not content, you'll find something within you. It's all about us. I remember years ago going to a talk for young people given by Josh McDowell. And he spoke about a time when he was young. He's retired now. And the question was, what do parents want for their children? And as he said, back in those days, they didn't do surveys. But if they had done, the parents would have said, I want my children to be good. And they had ways of making sure that we were good, and it hurt. But things have changed, and they do surveys now. So this again is back 20 years. And in the survey, well over 90% of the parents, when asked, said, I want my children to be happy. Now, don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with being happy. Being happy is very, very good. But if that's the sole motivation in life, it's not the type of love that the Bible speaks about. And I sat at the back of the meeting and I thought, just in my head, I thought, that's it. That sums up in many ways some of our problems in society, because what we have is, as long as you're happy. And so parents indulge their children in lots and lots of different things that they don't really need, but as long as they're happy. And families do the same. Even in workplaces nowadays, if you're reprimanded for doing something wrong, people will tend to walk away. Even in relationships, that's part of the problem in marriages. I'm just not happy anymore. I want to go to someone or something that will make me happy. You hear the self-seeking that's in that, in just wanting to be happy. The Bible teaches that by giving of ourselves, we will be happy, we will be blessed, and it will last. And it was a problem in the Corinthian church, because there were factions in there, factions about relationships. They were self-indulgent. They were concerned about food, what they can eat and what they couldn't eat. They were concerned about worship, styles of worship. I want it one way, I want it the other way. And even at communion, Paul says you come and you're not even speaking to each other. One goes ahead, doesn't even wait for others when it's supposed to be together. So this self-centered, this selflessness is for the church, not just for individuals. And the Bible says, love doesn't put yourself above others. Jonathan Edwards says, selfishness is a principle that contracts the heart and confines it to self, while love enlarges it and extends it to others. That's a good definition. Think about that. Selfishness is a principle that contracts the heart and confines it to self, while love enlarges it and extends it to others. And so when we look at what love is, we want God to show us. We want to look at the Bible and supremely in Jesus. In 1 John 4, we're told, here is love. Not that we love God. It's not our definition that sets the standard. It's God's. Here is love. Not that we love God, but that God loves us and gave his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Jesus died so that we might live. He gave himself for the well-being and salvation of others. And we find that in Romans 5, where Paul writes, while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one might dare to die. But God shows his love. And while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God gave himself to those who were in rebellion against him. And that's a whole new standard. So it's not just love your own. We see that in Jesus' ministry. In Matthew 26, he says, then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. Now that sounds a fairly normal scene. But of course, this is the night before his crucifixion. Taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me. And going a little further, he fell on his face and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. He went back and he found the disciples sleeping, and he went back to pray again. And we read in Matthew, my Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. And we're told in Matthew that he went a third time. And he was really distressed. Luke tells us he sweat, as it were, drops of blood. That's a sign of sheer intensity when the body is under tremendous stress. And so he rightly says, Lord, please let it work for me. If you're willing, take this cup from me. It's a cup of suffering. And then he said, not my will, but yours be done. And that's the about turn in the T-junction, isn't it? When we face these choices, not of crucifixion for us, but daily choices of what is comfortable, what suits us, what is best for us. We ask God to give it so many of our prayers. But to take that step and say, not my will, but yours be done, is setting the direction of agape love. If it is possible, take this cup from me. But love is not self-seeking. Not my will, but yours be done. And then Paul carries that. Paul presents us with Jesus in Corinthians, but also in Philippians 2. We come to this passage again and again in the past year of the pandemic. And so Paul is writing, especially in the context of love. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, and of course there is. Then he says, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility, count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among you, which is yours in Christ Jesus. And remember, of course, as a church, it's not just one person having to go out on a limb as Jesus did, but the church is being called that every member practice this. So you're secure in putting yourself out for others because others are putting themselves out for you. And by this will all people know that you are my disciples if you love one another, Jesus says. But Jesus doesn't just confine it to the church. He presents a challenge to us in reaching out to the world, he says in Luke chapter 14. When you give a dinner or a banquet, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbours, lest they also invite you in return and you be repaid. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. Do you hear that? Give to others who cannot repay you. That's agape love. And so we care for one another, of course, but it's to go beyond that. Jesus always reached beyond that, in this T-junction of the heart. You and I have a choice to make, and not just as individuals, but the same is true for a church, for a congregation. To consider as we close, consider a graph. Maybe not drawn a graph for a long time, but take the horizontal axis along and put labels on it. Labels including yourself, your family, your friends, your colleagues at work or on hobbies, your neighbours, your church, the world out there. Your enemies. And then on the vertical axis, get yourself a number of coloured pens. And in terms of percentages, roughly, you don't have to measure it out exactly. Feel free to do so if you wish. Then with different colours of pens, let one represent your money and how you spend your money. And draw a cross on the different categories where you think it will fit. And then your time. Your energy. Where do you give most of your time and your energy? What about your prayers? About your focus for ourselves as a church as well, we're to do that. How will it look? I suspect yours will look like mine, that most of our money, of course you start with your savings, that belongs to me still, doesn't it? When it comes to time, you spend a fair wee bit of sleeping, so of course we're meant to have time to ourselves. But how do we divide our time as individuals and as a congregation? And we will find that I consider self-centeredness one of the most basic of sins, one of the most deep-rooted of sins. We will find that it's there. And that God wants us to move forward. He wants us to be more like Jesus. To reach beyond ourselves, because love is not self-seeking. Let us just pause in prayer and reflect on the words that are in the Psalms. Search me, O Lord, and know my heart. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Lord, we confess that just by nature we are self-centered. We have to look after ourselves. But we know we take it further and we indulge ourselves and those nearest to us, so that our life is more comfortable. And you ask us, Lord, to take a step or two or three to set a journey to be more like Jesus. Help us, Lord, to consider those parts that we can change. We know we can't become like Jesus overnight. And we pray, Lord, you will help us travel this journey. In Jesus' name, amen. Questions are coming up as we listen to the song, I Stand Amazed in the Presence, takes us to Gethsemane and to the cross, and the prize of heaven at the end. If you're free on Wednesday at 8 o'clock, come and join us. I was going to put it off this week for half term, but I realise with us all being locked in, we're not seeing people very often, so you have the opportunity to have fellowship together. If you're able to make it, I look forward to seeing you there. May God richly bless you.
I stand amazed in the presence. for